Well, good morning and welcome to our online service this morning. We're so glad that you have joined us. Can we bow your heads and close your eyes as we open in a word of prayer? Father, we thank you this morning for another day that we could come together as your body to come and worship you, to come and praise you, give thanks unto you, to fellowship with our fellow brethren online, to give to you and to receive from your word through our man of God. And so we thank you for this morning. We are fully expecting to receive from you this morning. Our hearts are open, our minds are receptive, and we are in I receive zone this morning. And we thank you for what we're going to receive by your spirit and through your word in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Well, let's hand it over to the NCF worship team as we praise and worship our God together. Amen.
Persecution, tribulation, I'm persuaded nothing
Father, we thank you for this time of worship and praise we could have had in your presence. We bless you and we honor you that you are here and you are in every home. You are omnipresent and we sense your presence, we sense your spirit, and we are ready to receive all that you have for us this morning. We give you thanks for this now in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Well, once again, good morning, family and friends. On behalf of our pastors, Drs. Basil and Antrine, welcome to our online service this morning. We thank you for joining us. And if this is your first time logging on and streaming with us, welcome, a special welcome to you. Thank you. And we trust that you will join us again. We meet every week on a Sunday online, 8:30 a.m. in the morning and 6 p.m. in the evening. And that's every week until we can continue to resume together in our services. But we want to invite you to join us every Sunday morning and evening together with your family. It'll be an honor for our pastors to join you and fellowship with you in your home with your family. We would like to also encourage you that our pastor is on various social media platforms online and you can connect with him, and we encourage you to follow him. Right now on our screen you'll see the platforms and his social media handle. He's on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube, and every day there's a powerful scripture, powerful encouraging message he sends out. Every week there's an empowering clip that he sends out, and I know it'll be a great blessing and encouragement to you, especially for this challenging season that we are in globally. Well, on that note, I'm going to hand it over to our media team to play this week's empowering video clip by our pastor. I'll see you in a moment.
God caused us to be born again, his children. He caused us also to be born again, to be his sons. And because we are his sons, he put his Spirit, the Spirit of the resurrected, ascended Lord Jesus Christ into our hearts, and that Spirit of the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ leads us and guides us, and that's what we have to depend on these days. The Bible says we must lean not on our own understanding. We must move beyond being a flesh man, being a soul man, to being a spirit man. We must move into the Holy of Holies, to live in the Holy of Holies 24/7, every day of our lives. So we are in God, with God, and through God, and our Lord Jesus Christ. And so the Spirit of God is within you to show you and lead you what God has prepared for you. And as you follow his leading, light and glory will shine out of your life, and you will see what you've never seen, to do what you've never done, to go where you've never gone, and to have what you never had. And that's why you will prosper in total life prosperity, irrespective of the darkness that is covering the earth. In the name of Jesus.
Well, that was an awesome clip by our pastor, and that'll be available online, and you can watch it over again or even download it and share it. We want to encourage you, if you're following our pastor, please share the links for these services, share the videos that he sends out, the encouraging words that he sends out, because we believe that we are blessed to be a blessing to the families of the earth. And so in times like these, we want to spread the word of blessing, the word of encouragement to as many people as possible. Now, this weekend, we know is the Easter weekend that is coming up, and we have two services again this weekend. We normally have a service on a Sunday morning at 8:30 and a Sunday evening at 6 p.m., but this weekend it'll be a little bit different. We'll still have two services that we're streaming and that you can join us online. First meeting will be on Good Friday at 8:30 a.m., so kindly take note, Friday morning, Good Friday at 8:30 a.m., and then on Sunday morning, Resurrection Sunday at 8:30 a.m. as well. We won't be streaming in the evenings, so we won't be having online services in the evenings, but please join us with your families on Good Friday morning, 8:30 a.m., and Resurrection Sunday morning at 8:30 a.m. Now, this weekend and Good Friday, we'll be sharing communion together, and we want to encourage you and your family. When you do go out this week, maybe to do your grocery shopping, if you could get some grape juice or some bread and wafers or crackers, whichever you prefer, but we would like you to prepare together with your family as we partake of communion together in our Good Friday morning service at 8:30 a.m. And so that'll be this weekend, and we believe it's going to be a powerful time together. We may not physically be together, but in the spirit, we believe that as we partake of communion together with you and your family, led by our pastor, that we believe something powerful is going to happen, that supernatural breakthroughs will take place, deliverances, and we are expecting it, something powerful, as we remember our Lord's death and the price that he paid for us on the cross. And so thank you for all that you're doing as a family, as a church. Thank you for your faithful contributions on behalf of our pastors. We'd not be able to do what we do without your faithful financial contributions. Thank you for your tithes and your offerings that you are contributing electronically. And if you would like to sow a seed, give an offering, or put your tithe in, then we want to encourage you right now on our screen as our banking details, where you can EFT your tithe, your offering into the work of God and into our church bank account. We also offer this facility on SnapScan, where you can do it. It's very, very simple. If you download the app, and the snap code is on our screen as well, and you can easily just contribute whatever you would like to, whatever you desire to. And as a reference, we do encourage you, please, to put your name there, and whatever you are contributing into the church, whether it is your tithe or your offering. Now, on that note, we have a powerful video testimony we like to share with you by some of our leaders and members in our church, and I'm going to hand you over to our media team at this time as they play that video. And while they're doing that, you can do that EFT and do that transfer, and we'll receive it by faith, and we know that our pastors will be praying for you and releasing the blessing of God over you in Jesus' name. Thank you, media team.
Thank you for joining us once again on Reigning as Kings for this time of empowerment with our host, Dr. Basil Tryon. Today we are joined by faithful partners of Basil Tryon Ministries. Thank you so much, Neil and Laverne Rampona, for being with us today. We are truly blessed by your journey of faith. We have witnessed God manifest glory manifestations in your life, in your family, and your business. We would love to hear from you and let you share with us and the viewers the importance of spiritual connection, not as a cliche, but as a principle, and the blessings that spiritual partnership has brought into your lives.
Thank you, Pastor Christelle. For me personally, it's been a wonderful journey. We've been here for close on 2 years. Next month will be 2 years. And I've watched my family and my business grow by applying the principles that Dad Bishop teaches. One of them that is key for me is sowing and reaping. Mm-hmm. He's big on that, and he leads by example. Yeah. He's a Hebrew 6 man that says, yes, he must follow those who, by faith and patience, receive the promises, and I try to imitate him with that. In so doing, my business has gone from a level of being very mediocre to being dramatically increased, if I can call it that. So we have seen the fruits of that application, yeah, of that spiritual principle.
That is truly powerful. We acknowledge that you share the testimony of your faithfulness in tithing and in offering sowing. And the powerful principle that we want to also let the viewers be aware of is that in the year 2019, you had sown into your tithing, your amount, but we have found that because of the blessing of increase and the fruit of God's blessings, in this year, in a couple of months, you're already 80% of the total year. So we have seen acceleration. We know that you have applied the principles from the Word of God that Dr. Tryon has shared. If you, Laverne, could share with us, I know there's so many of them, but one that has impacted you personally.
Absolutely, Pastor Christelle. For me, Galatians 3:26-29 speaks of sonship. And Bishop has really imparted and impressed that upon our hearts, that we are heirs to the promise of Abraham. And as sons of Jesus Christ, we're free. We're no longer bound. We're not slaves. And sonship, for me, which may seem a bit of a contradiction, it's not male or female. I belong and I know who I am as Christ in me. And therefore, it has given me such liberation to understand my DNA, my identity, and the power and the authority that it gives me because of the Christ in me. And because of that, I personally have seen things dramatically change spiritually, emotionally, physically, and financially. And it's solely because of the understanding that I know who I am.
Awesome. What a journey of faith, Laverne. Truly, it's empowering for us to be able to see that manifest in and through your lives. As you know, the ministry program is entitled Reigning as Kings. And it's not just a cliche, but there's revelation locked up in that title. Before we turn to the ministry of God's Word, could you share with us, Neil, what revelation have you received from that title?
Powerful question, and a lot of bearing on my life, actually, very deep. And
yes.
The gravity of that has really hit me. Before I came here, I was just an ordinary businessman. And with Dad's teachings, he has taught us that we must reign and rule as kings. And I go out now into business and I plunder because I am a king. And Dad has taught us that we must go out and rule and reign as kings. So thank you to Dad.
Thank you for sharing those powerful principles from your lives that you have demonstrated. Once again, we want to say thank you, Neil and Laverne Rimpona.
Our blessed God and our Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I receive all the tithes and the offerings and confer the Melchizedek order blessing upon your people. In the name of Jesus, they belong to the Most High God. They possess all the resources of heaven and earth, and you are planting the heavens in the earth through the words that you put in their mouth and the shadow that comes off your hands that is upon your people, Lord. And you are saying unto the church, you are my people and you are pleased with them, Lord. And I thank you today. We dwell in the secret place of the Most High. We abide under the shadow of the Almighty. We all say of the Lord, he is our refuge, he is our fortress, he is our God. In him do we put our trust. In the name of Jesus Christ, my God supplies all your needs, your dreams, your desires in the will of God, according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I speak protection, immunity, and provision and guidance by the Spirit of God to be manifested through your lives. In Jesus' wonderful name, amen.
Well, family, this morning, we are ready to receive the word of faith from our man of God. But before we do that, can we do our faith declaration together? I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. My eyes are enlightened and I know the hope of God's calling on my life. I also know how rich is God's inheritance in me. Therefore, I know how valuable I am to God. I know the exceeding greatness of God's power as I totally identify with Jesus Christ's death, burial, resurrection, and ascension. I've been made alive together with Christ, raised up together with Christ, and seated together with Christ in heavenly places. Today I'm filled with the knowledge of His will, in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. I'm strengthened with might by His Spirit. Jesus Christ lives big in me. I'm rooted and grounded in God's love. I'm filled with all the fullness of God. God's power and love work in me exceedingly abundantly above all I've prayed for and dreamed about. I'm very prosperous in every area of my life. Therefore, I declare that my whole life, all that I am, all that I do and all that I own brings glory to my Lord Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, I'm blessed and filled with the life of God. Everything I do prospers, and I'm increasing in every area of my life. Family, I'm going to hand it over to Dr. Tryon at this time for the word. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Dale. Well, good morning to every one of you, and a warm welcome in the wonderful name of Jesus to all our online viewers. Well, it's church, still church, and the church is the body of Christ, but it's still church as normal because church is the body, and you and I are the church. And so God is bringing alignment and order that we don't see the meeting as the church, and we don't only see a building as the church, but we come to a realization that church is 24/7 for the body of Christ. Thank you for having me in your home, and we welcome all of you in Jesus' name. We are studying in the past two Sunday mornings a powerful, powerful truth in God's Word that we need to find our identity in God's perfect law of liberty. And that is the mirror of God, which shows us clearly that we are the sons of God. The Word of God is the mirror of God. And that mirror must operate from within our hearts. And when we can have our eyes opened and we can look into that mirror, then we are changed into the image that we see of the glory of God. I want to read a portion of scripture in James, and we are studying, now are we the sons of God. We are sons of God because of what Jesus Christ has done on the cross, and by virtue of the fact that Jesus is in our hearts and the spirit of sonship's in our hearts. We've covered 7 points, and you can get a download on YouTube of both the previous meetings, and you can study that. That's very powerful. And I'm going to go on to the 8th point, and it's all just so powerful. Reading from James chapter 1 from verse 22, "But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is likened unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass." That word glass is mirror. "For he beholdeth himself and goeth his way and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continued therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work." This is the work. "This man shall be blessed in his deed." So number 8, and the first point this morning, is sons of God are heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. In Romans chapter 8 and verse 17, "And if children, then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together." And I want to also read right along that in Romans 4:13, "For the promise that he should be the heir of the world was not to Abram or to his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith." Praise God. So I want to focus on that point, number 8, on these 3 truths that those 2 verses of Scripture show us in God's eternal mirror. And I just want you to know that you are God's eternal economy. The economy of this world is in wealth of this world, but the economy of the kingdom of God is people, and you are the economy of God. God puts a high premium on each one of you, and you are the wealth of God. Hallelujah. And God wants you, first of all, to see yourself as an heir of God. And he also wants you to see, number two, that you're a joint heir with Jesus Christ. And then he also wants you to see that you are an heir of the world. That means the whole world, which are the nations of the world, and the whole earth is your inheritance. First of all, if you're a child of God, then you're a son of God, and then you're an heir of God. There are two points there to being an heir of God. Number one, as an heir, you belong to God. It is God who gave you an inheritance. It's God who made you an heir. Therefore, you're an heir of God. It's the same like what Melchizedek said to Abram, "Blessed be Abram of the Most High God," meaning Abram belongs to the Most High God. So when God says you're an heir of God, then it means God made you an heir and you belong to God, and therefore you are God's heir. Ooh, Jesus, that is so powerful, isn't it? I sense the presence of the Lord when I say that. But then number two, on that same point, that you're an heir of God, it means all God's resources belong to you. His life, his nature, his ability, and his wealth is your inheritance. You're an heir of God. But more than that, all heaven's resources belong to you. And we will come to the next point just now. All earth's resources belong to you. So whatever God is for you. Whatever God can do is for you. Whatever God owns is for you. God shares himself totally with you. Number one, he makes you an heir. Number two, he is your inheritance. God becomes your inheritance. And then you're a joint heir with Jesus Christ. That means whatever Jesus Christ accomplished in his death, burial, resurrection, in fact, in his total incarnation, in his birth, his life, his death, his burial, his resurrection and ascension, whatever he inherited becomes your inheritance. It doesn't say you're a sub-heir of Jesus Christ's inheritance. You're a joint heir of Christ. And so that means whatever Christ accomplished as a son of man and as a son of God, he was doing it for you. And even though he entered into an inheritance, you enter into the same inheritance of what Jesus Christ accomplished. And so point number eight is that, number one, you're an heir of God. There's subtitle two there. Number one, God makes you an heir and you belong to God. Number two, and point number one is that God's life, nature, ability, and all that he owns is your inheritance. But then as we go to point number two, that you are joint heirs with Jesus Christ. It means whatever Christ inherited, and one of the things he inherited is a more excellent name. Christ inherited a more excellent name, and he gives us the power of attorney to use his name in this darkened world. Use his name in your declaration, in your decrees. Use his name in your prayers, and use his name as a weapon of warfare against coronavirus. And therefore, right now, I use that name of Jesus over all our hearers. In Jesus' name, I bind coronavirus and I cast it out of your body, and you will trample on serpents and scorpions, and nothing by any means shall hurt you, because the name of Jesus is above all the power of the devil. If you receive it, shout amen. Your power of attorney to use the name of Jesus, and that is your inheritance. But number three, the world is our inheritance. And so Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection paid a price that whatever Adam lost in the fall, God got it back in the resurrection and ascension, the death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus. God gave creation to Adam so that Adam, under the lordship of God, would be able to have stewardship, ownership, responsibility, and he would rule and dominate the earth. But because he fell, he committed high treason, and he gave over the earth with all the resources in the earth to the devil. And Paul was clear that Satan became the god of this world. But God so loved the world, he wanted to restore it back to man. First of all, he had to restore it back to himself. And he gave his only begotten Son. So Jesus Christ also went to the cross and paid the price for more than for man, but he paid the price also for creation. And through his death, burial, and resurrection, he overcame the devil, and he took back creation back to belong to God. But him doing that was for the purpose that creation would come back to the original managers and the owners of it, which God had given, which was to man. And so when man is restored, Jesus Christ also came to seek and to save that which man had lost. And man had lost dominion over the earth. And so when you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, then the earth, with all its wealth, and the nations of the earth become your inheritance. That's why in the Old Testament, the psalmist prophesied, "Ask of me for the nations for your inheritance, and the uttermost parts of the earth for your possession." Because all the nations of the world and the uttermost parts of the earth should belong to the sons of God. So now we have an inheritance, which is the whole world. So because we live here in South Africa, and then the land of South Africa is our inheritance. Because we are all South Africans, then this rainbow nation of South Africa is our inheritance. If you are watching this and whatever country you are living in, then the land of your country is your inheritance as well, and then your nation is your inheritance. Now, the land and the nation and the whole globe and all the nations of the world become the inheritance of the people of God. However, because of the fall of man, Satan caused distortion in creation, and he caused men's minds to be darkened and lack understanding. We are given the ownership responsibility to bring forth restoration to the earth and to humanity. So we see the nations of the world as the economy of God. We see the earth as a creation of God, where God put riches, and the earth is filled with the wealth or the riches of God. And so, as we push back the darkness of humanity, then we reap the nations of the earth to be the people of God. Now all the wealth that belongs to the nations of the world also belongs to God. So when those nations come into the kingdom of God, they will also come in with their wealth, and their wealth will be used because they are in partnership with God. Their wealth will be used to extend the kingdom of God. However, if the nations of the world, there'll be a segment of them that will harden their heart and they won't believe. Now, the shaking that's taking place, God said, I'll shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land. And the purpose of that shaking is that the things that can be shaken will be taken out, and the things that cannot be shaken will remain. And we're receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. We serve God with reverence. We serve God by grace with reverence and godly fear. Let's have grace whereby we may serve God. And so we understand that there's a wealth transfer that's taking place in the midst of this darkness and gloom that's upon the earth. There's a wealth transfer that's taking place where gross darkness is upon the people. And the way this transfer will take place is through us being glory carriers and light glory releasers. And as we release the light of God, of the glory, of the knowledge of God, right in that darkness of humanity is the economy of God. Right in that darkness that's upon the earth is the things that God prepared for those that love Him to be able to live in this earth and have all the resources they need to fulfill their kingdom mandate. And so the first point this morning, sons of God are heirs. Now they are not only children, because if they were children, we looked at that, they wouldn't be able to cash in their inheritance. But God designed the system in such a way that when you're born again as a child of God, you immediately adopted as a son of God, and therefore every child of God is a son of God, and the purpose of that is for you to have an inheritance manifestation. Now, as you use your faith for that, your faith is the title deed, and your faith will be based on exact knowledge, the Word of God rightfully divided, on revelation. So you use your faith and you take it by faith, and that is your title deed. But as soon as a manifestation takes place, then now faith has accomplished its work and you have knowledge of manifestation. You have exact knowledge of manifestation. And so just understand that before you have the manifestation, you won't have the knowledge of the manifestation as a manifestation. You will have the knowledge of God that it is your inheritance. Now your faith will be the title deed that takes the place before the manifestation. Now, as you operate that title deed, it's likened to an example that you can buy a piece of property without actually seeing that property. You can pay for that property and take ownership and have transfer of that property, even though you haven't seen that property, but you will have the title deeds. The title deeds is what guarantees you that the property is yours. Now, that's what faith is. Faith is your guarantee. Faith is your title deed. And you operate by faith, taking ownership of the nations of the world to be a blessing to the families of the earth. Yes, to be a blessing to the ungodly, because it's as you are a blessing to the ungodly that the goodness of God through your life, in the same way how the goodness of God through other people's life led you to the Lord, now you as a son of God demonstrate the goodness of God to the wicked people of the world, because God causes his sun to shine on the good and the unrighteous, the righteous and the unrighteous. God loves the ungodly, and God causes the rain to fall on the righteous and the unrighteous. The reason you and I got saved is because the goodness of God brought us unto repentance. And now God is going to use you and work through you for you to love the unsaved, for you to reveal the goodness of God to the unsaved, and through you revealing the goodness of God, multitudes of unsaved and backsliders will come to God and accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. As I said earlier, they come with all the wealth, and that's how the wealth will come into the kingdom of God and come into the churches of our Lord Jesus Christ for us to fulfill our kingdom mandate. The other side of that, the wealth still belongs to God. And so the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. And a good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children. The sinners who reject the gospel will experience a financial shaking where there will be wealth transfer. It'll be their wealth leaving them and coming into the kingdom of God. It's amazing in the times that we're living in, we are seeing billions and trillions on the stock market being wiped out like that, sometimes in just a matter of a few days. And so there's a tremendous movement of material wealth that's taking place in the time that we're living, and we understand it's on God's prophetic agenda. And so point number eight, it's crucial for you to understand that as a son of God, you're an heir of God, you're a joint heir with Jesus Christ, you're an heir of the world, the nations belong to you, and wherever you are, your nation first and foremost belongs to you, then all the nations of the world. Because I'm sharing from South Africa, in my context, the South African nation, a rainbow nation, belongs to me and belongs to the Christians here in South Africa. So when the unsaved hurt, when the nations hurt, then we are hurting with them, because we have the solution to their problems, and we have a debt to pay. And the only debt we have to pay is to love the unsaved and also to love one another. And so we are called by God to demonstrate the love of God, to be able to bring the goodness of God to the unsaved and keep the door open for them to get saved and come into the kingdom of God. So you need to understand, we're not at war with the unsaved. We're not rejecting the unsaved. We understand that we have the answers to their problems, and Jesus Christ is still the answer for the world today. And then the world belongs to us. All the land, all the wealth belongs to us. And so we are clear on this. And just make up your mind, God has given you title deeds of the whole world, the nations and the earth and all the wealth. And that title deed is actually the faith of God. So written in the faith of God is your inheritance. And so when you get skilled in how to use your faith, you now take possession of your inheritance in this life. And in the name of Jesus, I decree and declare over everyone that is listening to the sound of my voice that the knowledge of God is flowing into you right now. Revelation from heaven is coming into your heart, and you are being drawn into a life of glory and a life of excellence in God, in the mighty name of Jesus. And I decree it that this faith has glory and excellence written in it as your inheritance in the name of Jesus. And so you have immunity, you have protection, and you have provision in the darkest moments of life in the mighty, mighty name of Jesus. So I've got just over 4 minutes left. I'll touch on the ninth point, and that sons of God are the seed of Abraham, just as Jesus Christ is the seed of Abraham. Jesus Christ was the only begotten Son, but Jesus Christ becoming a Son of Man, because He was a God-man, bringing God to man, and He will take man into God, so man could become God-men in the earth, He became the seed of Abraham. And I want to read it in Galatians chapter 3, verse 26 to verse 29. Verse 26, "For you are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus." I want to keep on saying that when you see the word child of God, also means you are a son of God, because every child of God is a full-grown son in Christ through what Christ accomplished. And it goes on to say in verse 27, "For as many of you as have been baptized, immersed into Christ, have actually put on Christ." Verse 28, "There is now neither Jew nor Greek, neither Jew nor Gentile." There's no more differentiation of nations. That's what that means. The middle wall between races is broken down. There's only one race in the kingdom of God, that is a Christ nation. And so there's neither Jew nor Gentile. Then there's neither bond nor free. There's no slaves, a differentiation between slaves and masters of slaves. We are all the sons of God now. And there's neither male nor female. So the females, the ladies, are just as much sons of God, spiritually speaking, as a man, as a male. And so there's no middle wall separating male and female in Christ Jesus. It's broken down through the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. And it tells us, "For you all are one in Christ Jesus." And then verse 29 goes on to say, "And if you be Christ's, then are you Abram's seed and heirs according to the promise." Now you, as a son of God, you need a clear understanding that as you're looking into this mirror, when you accepted Jesus Christ and God made you His son, He also made you the seed of Abraham, because it's through the seed of Abraham that the nations and the world can become our inheritance, and we'll see next week, through the blessing of Abraham. And so you are the seed of Abraham just as much as Christ is the seed of Abraham, because you were baptized or immersed into Christ, and you have put on Christ, and your position in the kingdom of God is you are in Christ now. By virtue of the fact that the Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he is a brand new creation. Old things are passed away, and come and see, all things have become new. We become the seed of Abraham. So, as I conclude, you being a seed of Abraham is the same seed, Christ. So the DNA in that seed is Son of Man, Son of God. And therefore, the DNA in your life is that you are a Son of Man without sin, but you're also a Son of God. So in the earth, you are an extension, so to say, of the Godhead in heaven. I trust that you've been blessed today in the wonderful and precious name of Jesus Christ. These two powerful truths can carry you through this next week as you meditate on this, and you can download these notes on YouTube and go over them again. And we said, number one is that you are an heir. You have an inheritance, and you must cash that inheritance, and you do that by faith. Faith is your title deed, and faith will manifest it. And then number two, you must also see yourself as a seed that God wants to plant in the world for you to take over the world. And that's the kingdom of God. So God richly, richly bless you. I declare over your life that this coronavirus is extinct in the name of Jesus. I speak immunity, protection over yourself, your spouse, your children, your grandchildren. Your household is saved. And household salvation means that there is immunity of salvation in that household. And so in the name of Jesus, coronavirus, I speak to you that I resist you of the people of God, and you will not kill anybody, but we will live and declare the goodness of God in the land of the living. The darker the situation, the more glorious the victory. And so rise up out of your doldrums, stop focusing on the problem, and look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. For you that are here watching, in your homes, wherever you're watching, and you realize that the world is so dark and you are not saved. And as you are listening to me, the Holy Spirit is saying to you now, why don't you give your life to Jesus? I want to lead you in a prayer where you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior and accept the work of the cross, the burial and resurrection of Jesus, and you will never ever be alone again. If you want to do that, repeat this prayer after me. Put your hand on your heart and say, Dear Lord Jesus Christ, I believe with all my heart that you died for my sins and you rose again on the third day for my sins to be blotted out, that I may become innocent because you took my sins upon yourself. Please forgive me. I open up my heart, come into my life, and be the Lord of my life. With my heart, I believe that God raised you from the dead. With my mouth, I confess you, Lord Jesus, as my Lord, my Savior, my King, in the name of Jesus. Dear friend, if you prayed that prayer, today is your spiritual birthday, and all these blessings we're talking about, sonship, all belong to you. I decree and declare in the name of Jesus that Jesus got you in the hollow of his hand, and no one can pluck you out. Today is your spiritual birthday, the first day of the rest of your life. Congratulations. God richly bless you. Dear friends, before I say goodbye and before I depart you with the blessing of God, I want to remind you that tonight is Faith Clinic. 6 o'clock is Faith Clinic. And these are the days where we need to be skilled in faith. Gather your family together. Gather your loved ones. And I will be there in your lounge or living room or wherever you're watching with your family. And I will be skilling you with a word of faith for you to be the ruler who God created you to be. God richly bless you. We love you with all our hearts. And it's such a privilege to minister to you. Thank you so much. Amen.